Tenemos this video is spherical. Capacitor. This is an example where I'm going to use the Dirichlet problem to find the capacitance of a spherical capacitor. What is a spherical capacitor? It's comprised of an inner hard sphere made from a perfectly conducting material. This sphere is characterized by a radius capital R1. Again, this is a hard sphere. So there is conducting material everywhere. Then there is a vacuum gap, and at a distance capital R2, there is the inner surface of a shell, also perfectly conducting material, with some thickness T. So let's sketch it. So this is vacuum here, a vacuum gap all around the sphere, also spherical shape with same center here. And this shell has some thickness. So the thickness is T. The radius here is capital R2. This surface, we call it capital sigma 1. This surface, we call it capital sigma 2. So capital sigma 1 is the outer surface of the hard sphere. Capital sigma 2, at distance capital R2, that's why 2, is the inner surface of this shell of charge. And so this one is also, so it's not a shell of charge, of a conducting shell, okay? Let's then hypothesize that we do charge the inner hard sphere by means of a charge plus Q. Now, if we consider a Gaussian surface capital sigma, which is closed and entirely contained within the thickness of the shell, of the conducting shell, and this surface, we call it just capital sigma, is a Gaussian surface. Now, we want to find, we've done this already in 242, but quickly, what are the charges everywhere else in this system? And so in order to do so, we need to impose the two conditions of total electrostatic induction. The first condition of total electrostatic induction derives from Gauss's theorem in fact applied to the surface capital sigma as defined here. We know that if all these conductors are in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium conditions, the electrostatic field at each point within the shell has to be zero, and so the flux through capital sigma has to be zero, which corresponds to tell us that there must be a charge, since the total charge has to be zero within this capital sigma, there must be a charge minus Q on capital sigma 2. And this is a very brief discussion I'm doing here. You've done this very much in detail in 242. So there will be a charge minus Q on the surface sigma, capital sigma 2. In addition, since we assume that the shell was initially uncharged, it has to remain uncharged throughout the experiment, and therefore there must be a charge plus Q on the external surface, which we can call capital sigma X. We're not going to use it too much, so let's just call this surface here capital sigma X. There will be a charge plus Q right here. So that we have plus Q, minus Q is zero, and the overall charge of the system remains Q, the one which I applied somehow to this hard sphere at the beginning of the experiment, total electrostatic induction, which in fact is the best kind of capacitor you can get. So if you do total electrostatic induction, that's the best, the ideal capacitor. In real life, every capacitor is a little bit worse than this. This confines all the electrostatic field within this vacuum gap. All right, so now let's define, as always, a coordinate system. This is R. In a spherical coordinate system, this is the origin. The normal unit vector pointing along R is UR. The normal unit vector, for example, at this surface, capital sigma 2, is N2. And the normal unit vector at capital sigma 1, it's N1. It so happens that N2 points in the opposite direction of UR, so it's equal to minus UR, whereas N1, of course, is plus UR. So now we want to find the capacitance of this object, and so we know by definition of capacitance, the capacitance for a system of two conductors, which are balanced plus Q minus Q, has to be equal by definition to the positive charge Q plus divided by V associated with the positive charge minus V associated with the negative charge, and this quantity is typically what we call a delta V. But always remember, by convention, it's positive minus negative, and the charge is the positive one, so plus Q in this case. Since we want to find a potential difference, we want to find the potential, in particular, everywhere, at any point, capital P, within the vacuum gap. So for this problem, I don't care about points within the hard sphere, on the shell, or outside the shell. In fact, I let you solve the entire problem in Piazza. This is a question that I have for you. So in Piazza, the question is solve everywhere, which we have done already in a home assignment in FIS 242, as a matter of fact. Here I will just focus on this vacuum gap region because it's the one I need in order to find the capacitance. And so the first step, we're using the Laplace equation that is the Dirichlet problem. I could choose to use this Dirichlet problem with respect to sigma 1 or sigma, capital sigma 1 or 2. I will go for 2, and then I will tell you in a minute what I would actually do. So the first step is, as always, the first step is to solve Laplace equation everywhere in vacuum. Laplace equation for spherical symmetry, we know that gives us a V in this spherical coordinate system of R equal a parameter unknown, alpha over R plus beta, two parameters because it comes from a Laplace equation. The second condition we typically would like to use is the normal conditions at infinity, which in this case we can specify is just R going to infinite. But I really am not going to use it because I only want to find the potential difference in this confined region of space, so I'm not going to go all the way to infinity. If you want to solve the problem everywhere, you need to use it. So this is useful to solve the problem everywhere. And eventually, this allows us to set beta. But since I want to compute a delta B, this beta, you will see, cancels out. So I don't even have to calculate it. I don't have to compute it. So the second step, the third step, we basically skipped it. The third step, and most important step, is Coulomb's theorem, which, again, I could choose to do it with respect to either the surface sigma, capital sigma 1, or capital sigma 2. I will choose to use it to do it for capital sigma 2, that is, the skin approaching capital sigma 2, which I need to use, is what I will call capital sigma 2, but I'm approaching from inside, because there is no other way to approach, so it's actually from minus. Okay, that's why I'm doing it, because it's a more complicated example. If I were to do it on approaching capital sigma 1, I would use this quantity, which would be a capital sigma 1 plus. So in Piazza, I want you to solve it for another question that I have for you. Do it with respect to capital sigma 1 plus Coulomb's theorem, okay? That's another question for you. So I do it for capital sigma 2 minus, and so the procedure tells us that we need to compute minus from the E equal minus gradient of V. Then we want to do the integral with respect to sigma 2 minus, which effectively, it's a limit. The limit, I can bring it inside the sign of integral. So here I don't put the minus because I put the limit here for small r, which goes to capital R2, which is the radius of the inner surface, minus, because I'm approaching it from below. And so this is the limit I want to do. Now, the next thing I want to do, I want to compute the normal derivative with respect to M2. And let's keep it generic for a minute, of V. And this one would be dA. What is this normal derivative? Well, we keep the minus sign, we keep the integral on capital sigma 2. Okay, I explicitly wrote the limit, otherwise I could just write capital sigma 2 minus, but I put the limit there. So now, in fact, let me put this for simplicity for a minute. I do like this. This is the same as the limit, so we remember, remind ourselves the notation. So I'll just move the limit into this notation here, sigma 2, capital sigma 2 minus. What is this normal derivative? Well, is the derivative with respect to the only variable of V which we have, which is R. But note that M2 point is minus UR, so we pick another minus sign from this M2, which is minus UR. What happens if you do with respect to capital sigma 1 plus, where N1 is UR? You will tell me. So we pick a minus sign. So we now explicitly wrote with respect to this coordinate system M2. And now we want, the first thing we do, remember in the previous video, we want to compute the, before doing the limit, the derivative of V with respect to R with this minus. And this is, V that goes away, is minus half over R squared. So one more minus. dA. Okay. So now we're almost there, because now we are doing the surface integral. So we have minus minus, cancel out. We have one more minus here. So finally, we have a minus. The integral is on the surface. So from 0 to pi of d theta sine theta. Integral from 0 to 2 pi d bar phi. These are all the integrals. And then minus, we have it. Minus minus is plus, minus is there. Now we are doing the limit. So the limit for r which goes to r2 minus, it's nothing but alpha over r2 square. So now I do the first of the derivative, then I perform the limit. So I've done this limit here. dA, we already have it, because it's all given by this quantity. And so as a result, this of course, there is one part missing in the dA, which is the radius r2 quantity square. So these two cancel out. And so I'm simply left with minus 4 pi alpha, which has to be equal to the total charge on capital sigma 2, which we know it's minus q over epsilon naught. And so we have alpha, which is plus q over 4 pi epsilon naught, as expected. We know this to be Coulombian type, so 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught q makes sense that this is my alpha. I'm not explicitly writing it, but you can do it, takes 2 seconds, right? It's right there. Okay, so now from Coulomb's theorem, we found alpha. The fourth and fifth condition, which are about the equipotential, you can verify that, for example, this surface capital sigma 1 is equipotential, obviously, because you just calculate this potential at capital R1. Similarly, capital sigma 2 is also equipotential. I let you do that. We don't need to stitch up anything, even though if you solve it everywhere, you need to do so, and then you need to use the fact potentially that this potential is a continuous function. So we skip these steps 4 and 5, okay? So 4 and 5 are eventually needed if you want to really solve it everywhere. So not in this case of the capacitance, it's simpler. But the key I really wanted to explain is with an example, it was Coulomb's theorem, that's the most complicated one. And so I urge you really to do it on capital sigma 1 plus, you should get the same result, alpha equal plus q over 4 pi epsilon naught. All right, so now that we have all that, we want to compute finally c. And so how do we do that? Well, we have alpha. So when we do delta v, we want V associated with the positive surface, which is capital sigma 1. And so it's going to be alpha, which is Q over 4 pi epsilon naught from this condition over here. Then I want to compute it at 1 over R, but capital R1, because it's the positive surface, minus the negative surface. And this actually is very reassuring, because capital R2 is larger than capital R1, which means this quantity is positive. So we get a positive result, which is what we wanted, because the capacitance in the end, we want it to be positive. So this makes sense. And now we just need to finally compute C, where we simply divide the positive charge, which is Q, divided by this quantity here. So this has to be Q divided by this quantity, which is 4 pi epsilon naught in the numerator divided by Q. So Q and Q cancel out. And here I have R1, R2 times R2 minus R1. So this I can rewrite it as in the denominator R1, R2, and here R2 minus R1, which again is a positive quantity because R2 is larger than R1. And so I need to divide by that. And so I obtain R1, R2 divided by R2 minus R1, which again is positive, which is very reassuring. The units in this case are farad, capital F, or small farad, spelled like this. These are the SI units of the capacitance, okay? So the capacitance is nothing but 4 pi epsilon naught R1, R2 divided by R2 minus R1, which is a positive quantity in farad. So to summarize this video, we consider a spherical capacitor, which is comprised of an inner hard sphere made of conducting material with radius capital R1, and a shell, which has some thickness. We didn't care about the thickness because we only want to find capacitance. So we are really interested in the vacuum gap. Total electrostatic induction tells us that if we have plus Q on this hard sphere, there must be a minus Q on the inner surface of the shell. Capacitance is Q over delta V. Remember the notations of positive, positive minus negative. Spherical symmetry, so V of R is alpha over R plus beta in the Laplace problem. Case 2, we don't need it. The part 2 of the method in this case, because I'm only interested in this vacuum gap, not going to infinity. The key thing is Coulomb's theorem, which are done on purpose for the most complicated surface, which is capital sigma 2 minus, that is approaching capital sigma 2 from inside. Do it for capital sigma 1 plus. By doing that, we find alpha, which is a positive quantity and is Q over 4 pi epsilon naught. Calculate delta B. Beta goes away, right? Because it's plus beta minus beta when I do the difference, so we don't care about this beta. And divided by Q by that quantity, we obtain the final expression for the capacitance, which is very important. That's it.